This V12 engine, manufactured by Daimler Benz, was completely inverted, with the crankshaft on top and the pistons below, being one of the most important engines of the German manufacturer. But why would someone make an inverted engine? What would be its advantages? And why would someone join two engines to reach incredible power values that exceed 3,000 horses? In 1930, Germany needed engines with more than 800 horsepower for its air force. These engines also had to have an ultra-compact cooling system that did not produce aerodynamic losses. They had to run on low-quality fuels and be easy to repair, as well as allow the placement of machine guns in the front for better aiming aligned with the pilot's vision, and allow excellent downward visibility, be totally inverted, among many other impossible things. The response from Daimler Benz was the DB600 engine. The first thing they did was building the block using Doral, an advanced alloy of aluminum, magnesium, and copper, which allowed for rapid heat conduction and thus ensured that it was uniform throughout the engine. In addition, this alloy is very light and, above all, resistant. The cylinder liners contained silicon, making them wear resistant. When inverted, the oil fell and remained on the underside of the pistons, which were removed when they moved back. This ensured that a large amount of oil touched the pistons, cooling them. This is the equivalent of using oil injectors under the pistons as used in cars today. The pistons are made of light alloy. Since they were upside down and had a diameter of 150 and a stroke of 160 millimeters, they had to use a large number of rings. In total, 5, 3 of which were for compression and 2 oil scrapers. This was the only way to prevent oil from passing through the rings into the combustion chamber and burning. In fact, if the engine was stopped for a long time, the cylinders could become flooded with oil and spark plugs had to be removed and cleaned. The lower ring also helped to center the piston in the cylinder. Otherwise, while being so long, it would produce a pitching effect, which makes noise and accelerates wear. Although the engine had a displacement of 33.9 liters or 2,070 cubic inches, giving each cylinder 2.8 liters, the engine was also fitted with a supercharger that was initially driven by a shaft connected to the crankshaft. This compressor increased power at takeoff and then maintained it when it rose and encountered less dense air. With its supercharger and 33.9 liters of displacement, it produced up to 1,000 horsepower at just 2,800 RPM and weighed less than 1,500 pounds. Fork and blade connecting rods are used on the same crank pin. That is, one goes inside and the other outside. This makes the cylinders be perfectly aligned and not staggered as in engines where the connecting rods are next to each other. In addition, needle roller bearings were used to allow the aircraft to operate for a short period without oil and let the pilot return to base. Thanks to being inverted, the pistons would remain lubricated with the remaining oil. The initial compression ratio was 6.9 to 1. In the aircraft world, engines usually have redundant systems, meaning that if one fails, the engine continues running by the second. For this reason, the engine had 2 spark plugs per cylinder, each one powered by 1 independent magneto. Also, since the cylinder was so large, using 2 spark plugs is the only way to fully fire the cylinder in time. If a magneto failed and a spark plug stopped working, the engine would continue to run, but with a small loss of power. However, the ideal would have been for the spark plugs to be placed opposite each other rather than next to each other. This would have achieved better fuel burning, but due to space and because of the injector, they were placed on the same side. Valve covers also serve as oil pans. In each of these, there are oil pumps that raise the fluid to the tank where the pressure pump is located. This system is also known as a dry sump. This allows the engine to operate in any position, since as long as there's oil in the pressure tank, the engine will maintain lubrication. The camshaft was also in this area and was driven by gears. In fact, the end of the road are the oil pumps. Then we go to the camshaft, and from here, a shaft then goes up to these gears. Here's the one that feeds the compressor and is connected to the crankshaft. In transparent, you can see the gear that runs on the first one and feeds the camshafts. There's one camshaft on each side that rotates at half the speed of the crankshaft. The same cam drives both the exhaust and intake valves. Each cylinder has 2 intake valves and 2 exhaust valves. Another detail is that the gears of the camshafts are inverted. This one has it like this and the other backwards. This is to maintain the direction of rotation. Since it was inverted, the exhaust pipes were in the lower part, ensuring that any oil in the exhaust would not dirty the windshield. Also during night flight, the short exhaust manifold flares would not interfere with the view. One thing I want to show you is how to solve meals simply with Factor. Factor makes meeting your nutrition goals easier than ever by delivering fresh, never frozen, dietitian-approved meals right to your doorstep. A team of gourmet chefs create each meal using only ingredients with integrity to help you feel your best all day long. Get chef-prepared meals on the table in 2 minutes with Factor's ready-to-eat meals, so you can get back to soaking in the summer sun. Factor meals eliminate the hassle of prepping, cooking, or cleaning up. Simply heat and savor the good stuff. Factor is so flexible that I can easily adjust my order size, enjoy with loved ones, or even skip a week when I have a special event. Factor is a go-to lunch solution when I'm in my home office. Enjoying a delicious menu is the best way to raise your spirits and then get back to work. Check out this one called Protein Plus, my favorite. Head to factor75.com or click the link below and use code REPAIRMAN50 to get 50% off your first Factor box and 20% off your next month of orders. That's code REPAIRMAN50 at factor75.com to get 50% off your first box plus 20% off your next month of orders. That's 50% off the first box, 20% off the next 4 boxes. Additionally, the inverted engine with the crankshaft output at the top allows for the installation of a reduction gear and the reduction of the propeller speed. The engine rotated at a maximum of 2800 RPM and the propeller at 1700. This is to avoid the tip of the propeller exceeding the speed of sound. The spark plugs and maintenance was within reach of the mechanic. This also left more room for machine guns to be mounted in the pilot's line of sight, which improved aim. It could also fire through the center of the propeller. Thanks to the space between the V, a duct was left to fire a 30mm MK-108 cannon that was at the rear. If you looked at the engine from the front, you could see the other side. Other smaller 20mm cannons were also fitted. The idea of having the gun centered on the plane means that when firing, the recoil of the weapon is absorbed into the center of the plane, avoiding vibrations or decreased aim, while the weapons that were on the wing tended to vibrate and decrease their accuracy. When chasing and doing high-speed maneuvers, the wings bend and the cannons lose their aim. The two smaller machine guns on top were synchronized with the propeller so as not to hit the blades. The inverted position of the engine also helps to keep the aircraft's center of gravity, making it more maneuverable. The third thing that was sought was that the engine, instead of working with coolant at 195 degrees Fahrenheit or 90 degrees Celsius, as we have today in our cars, was increased to 250 degrees Fahrenheit or 120 degrees Celsius. With an extra 55 degrees, the difference between the air and the radiator increases, which makes the same radiator perform better. This would allow the radiator to be shrunk to almost half the size of the original. This would give smaller air intakes and better aerodynamics. Also, with smaller radiators and less water, the weight is also reduced. But how do you prevent steam from forming? Initially, water boils and turns into steam at 212 degrees Fahrenheit or 100 degrees Celsius, as long as we're at atmospheric pressure. But if the radiator and its entire circuit are closed and the pressure is increased, the boiling point rises progressively. But as a downside, as there is more pressure, the system must be stronger. A slight weakness under high pressure would be unforgivable. In the event of a system failure or a bullet hitting these components, the closed circuit would break and the pressure would drop rapidly. Since the water is at 250 degrees Fahrenheit, the result would be an immediate evaporation of all the coolant, with subsequent total breakdown of the engine. However, this was not achieved satisfactorily and the operating temperature remained around 212 degrees Fahrenheit. Since the engine was operating at high temperature, another problem appeared. The first DB600s were fueled by carburetors, reliable and well-known. But Germany did not have the capacity to produce high-quality octane fuels. In fact, it could barely produce fuel at all. Heat promotes knocking, and as a result of this uncontrolled effect, instant detonations can destroy the engine. The only way was to reduce the engine's compression ratio, which reduces power and worsens fuel consumption. The result was the DB601, launched in 1935. Instead of losing power, the German manufacturer Bosch came up with a solution: the birth of mechanical gasoline direct injection. Although diesel injection already existed, gasoline is much more aggressive and attacks the seals and O-rings of the pump. It's also not a lubricant like diesel, which causes the pump pistons to wear out quickly. Overcoming these challenges meant that Bosch's invention needed to be kept as a complete state secret. France, the Soviet Union, and other countries wanted to buy the engine, but the government did not allow export to its future enemies. The pump consisted of 12 inline pistons that raised the fuel pressure to 90 bar and then injected it directly into the combustion chamber. The spray injection method was difficult to solve, as a large amount of fuel hit the cylinder liner and took out the oil. Then, when the piston passed, it would rub and break. Later, the spray was made wider with a special nozzle, and partly because the engine was running inverted, the extra oil helped. Direct injection, when entering directly into the cylinder, evaporates. By simply changing from a liquid to a gaseous state, it absorbs a large amount of heat and lowers the temperature of the cylinder. By lowering the temperature, knocking is avoided, allowing the use of low-octane fuels such as those available in Germany. Thanks to direct injection, the aircraft could fly in any conditions and perform all kinds of maneuvers, such as prolonged vertical climbs or inverted flight, where a carburetor float bowl would simply run dry. Another technology incorporated into this new version was the hydraulically operated supercharger. The crankshaft drives the gear that feeds the torque converter. The amount of oil inside the torque converter, managed by an automatic system according to the altitude, allows it to control the speed of the compressor. As the plane climbed, the air became thinner and lost power. But by adjusting the compressor speed, this problem simply disappeared. By this time, the compressor pressure was around 20 psi. With this, it now generates 1,300 horsepower at 2,600 RPM. The engine was also suitable for short-term operation with nitrous oxide or water methanol injection, ideal for escaping when being pursued by another fighter. Power could be increased to 2,300 horsepower. Manufacturers such as Fiat or Kawasaki received the blueprints of these engines to build and equip their fighters in their respective countries. The DB605 would now be slightly larger at 35.7 liters and would generate 1,475 horsepower at takeoff. If high-octane fuel was used, power could increase to 1,800 horsepower. Now, the compression ratio of the right bank would be 7.3 to 1, while the left bank, where the compressor is, would be 7.5 to 1. The reason was that knocking only occurred on this side, and therefore it was solved by lowering the compression on that bank. The reason was that supposedly, due to the direction of rotation of the crankshaft, more oil fell into this bank, which then passed to the combustion chamber and caused knocking. The roller bearing was also removed and plane bearings were installed. Later, in search of more power, two engines were joined in parallel and connected by gears. They were called the DB610. These engines were so tightly packed that changing an inner cylinder spark plug was impossible without disassembling the exhaust manifold, which required removing at least one engine. The compression ratio of the internal cylinders was lower because they worked hotter, and more oil fell on them because they were almost vertical, and there was at least 0.2 points less in compression ratio versus the external ones. These twin engines were used in the Heinkel HE-177 bomber, producing 2,900 horsepower. Although they were two inverted V12 engines, they were considered to be a 71-liter W24. Was the idea of using an inverted engine really crazy? No. In fact, in radial engines, the lower cylinders are inverted, and they existed before. My name is Francis, and if you like this video, don't forget to subscribe and leave a like. Also, check out the comments section, which is very important. There are always interesting things to read. See you next time!